We got about half of a session here in terms of time, so we're going to kind of go over this a little bit again, I think. Maybe I can tell you a personal story, and then in the next session I'll tell you the most important story for me, and it has to do with my dad. But I want to just briefly go over this again. So the first three columns on 65 are simply the story of why I'm angry. It's all it is just trying to get these things down on paper. And then you come up across on 66 at the bottom, and this idea, we realize that the people who wronged us were perhaps spiritually sick, though we did not like their symptoms, and the way these disturbed us, they, like ourselves, were sick too. We ask God to help us see it differently. That's basically what it's saying. We ask God to help us show them the same tolerance, pity, and patience we would cheerfully grant a sick friend. So this is an attitude change I'm having. I'm changing my attitude. When a person offended, we said to ourselves, this is a sick man. How can I be helpful to him? I mean, these are all prayers. God, save me from being angry. Your will be done. My will is to punish and get even. God's will is to love and help him. I'm out of harmony with God when I'm angry. So these are all prayers. Thy will. They took that directly out of the Oxford groups. That was one of the main things that they put a lot of emphasis in, was God's will, not mine, be done. So it's, we avoid retaliation or argument. Maybe we should pass these sheets out.
That's a wonderful idea.
You want to get them?
Yeah. It's a novel idea. Yeah. It's a good thing you guys said something. We got enough so you can take probably a couple a piece if you want. But you know, we tried to keep these sheets as accurate to the book as we possibly could. And if there's, in the breaks and stuff, if you got something that you want to share, if there's something that you think we should change or something, let me know what it is. I'll look at it. You know, I'm open to that. I'm not rigid about this. You know, we tried to get a sheet printed so that we could keep it accurate. There's a lot of sheets out there that aren't accurate to the book. And it's unfortunate because it's brought an awful lot of confusion into the process. So we destroy our chance of being helpful. We cannot be helpful to all people, but at least God will show us how to take a kindly and tolerant view of each and every one. Each and every one where? On the list of people we're angry at. At least God will help us do that, all right? So what we did on the front of the sheet, you can see it looks just like it does in the book. We put the text that pertains to each column above the column. So you could write it right off the sheet. We didn't change it. I don't think we changed anything here. We just put it as to where it was relevant to the columns. Okay? Then on the back of the sheet, we just put our own mistakes and broke the questions up in the middle of page 67 and left a place to write. And you'll notice on the back where it says, where had we been selfish? It says, acting without concern for others. Where had we been selfish? Acting without concern for others. Where had we been dishonest? Dishonest to get what I want. Dishonesty can take many forms. It can be in the form of lying or stealing. It can be in deceiving. I'll give you an example of what I used to do with my dad. I used to go and tell my dad sad stories of how bad my life was. I wanted money from him. See, I wanted him to give me money. Now, I didn't say, Dad, will you loan me money? Because you have to pay that back if you borrow money. You understand? But if I could manipulate him through the story, he would often offer me money. Now, I was pretty good at this. And, you know, but one time in particular, I'll never forget it. I'm telling my dad a story, and he's not picking his cues up properly. You following me? In other words, he didn't offer me money. And then I left angry at him because he didn't give me the money I didn't ask for. And I gossiped about him and slammed him to my sister or somebody, you know. I was notorious for that kind of crap. Putting the guy down. So that was the exact nature of my mistakes. That might actually fall under both dishonest, and it might fall under self-seeking and frightened. Bob's kid used to do that to him.
No, my kid came to a workshop a few years ago and heard Rick tell that story. It changed his whole life.
It ruined his experience.
Yeah. You mean you're on to me when I'm trying to manipulate you to get money? So now he just asked for the money.
Yeah. Well, that's an improvement. At least that's more straightforward, you know? Right. You understand? Okay. So dishonesty can take many forms like that. That kind of crap, see? So, and then where had we been self-seeking and frightened? Now, this has always been a tough one for people to understand. Now, this is just my understanding. It's my opinion about this, okay? This is what I gained from working with guys and doing this stuff. The way I see this today is where had we been self-seeking and frightened? Now, some guys want to separate frightened from it, but there is a separate fear inventory, and the fear always comes up in the resentments under where I'm afraid of not getting what I want or losing what I got. It's really about what am I afraid of losing, but we often ask guys to look at what am I afraid of not getting too. But afraid of not getting is really afraid of losing. You'll see that as you get more and more into the process of it, okay? So we put the sheet, since the question in the book was, where had we been self-seeking and frightened, we put in parentheses here. Afraid I'll lose what I have or not get what I want, so I did something to them. Do you see that? Yeah. If I'm seeking for myself, I'll be what? I'll be afraid of not getting what I want, right? And then I'll do something like with my dad. I'll gossip about him and slam him to my sister because he didn't give me the money. I was afraid of not getting what I want, and that was the exact nature of my mistake then, you see? This is really a real typical thing that a lot of us do, and the awareness isn't very good on this particular thing. This helped me to start to see it, where I was playing those games. So that's the way that looks, okay?
You guys heard in inventory, I'm looking for my part. You heard that? Yeah, it's really important that I'm looking not for my part, but for my mistakes. If I'm looking for my part, I'm angry at you for a particular event, and now I'm going to look for my part in that particular event. And in order to look for my part, I have to look at your part. And I did what I did because you did what you did, and we go through that whole process. That's why he says twice in this paragraph, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done. I have to look for my mistakes in an entire relationship. Now, Rick was mad at his dad. I was not mad at my dad. I had a good relationship with my dad. But I could sit here right now. My dad died 40 years ago. I could sit here right now and make up a story about how my dad did something to me that ruined my life. If my dad had only done blah, 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 I could talk myself into something like that right now. I could make up a story. So my mistake, not my part of an event, my mistake in an entire relationship. That's what I want to look for. Putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, looking for our own mistakes. That's really important. Don't look for your part.
In fact, if you could not say that, it would be helpful. It's all over the place in the meetings, at least where I come from. I don't know what it's like out here, but in the Minneapolis area, it's like, God, can't we just quit with that, you know? Because it gives newcomers an impression that we're looking for our part of something. No, we're simply looking for our mistakes in that relationship. Now, let's say the event was the only relationship. Maybe it was something that just happened. It was an event. Well, then you might look at where you made mistakes that led up to the event. And you might start to see things like I started to see, well, I put myself in positions to get hurt. You know, my lifestyle put me in positions to have those experiences. So even though somebody did something that was absolutely wrong, you know, there's a tendency to want to just focus on what they did and justify, well, I was a victim of that thing. Well, maybe I put myself in a situation where that could happen. I don't know what it's going to look like for somebody else. All I can really do is report what's happened to me. Now, here, I can give you a story of something that happened. All right? This was, and I tell this story because I want to tell you a story later on tonight about my dad. And it helps if I tell you this because you'll understand my background. And this is a little more involved than what you'd probably write in terms of the inventory. But I want to give you the background and stuff of what went on in my life, so you'll understand these things as we share them. I had a house. I had a big triplex that I was trying to hang on to. And this is back in the late 70s, early 80s. Okay, you know, the economy went bad like it is now, only it was worse. You couldn't borrow money at all. I mean, it was just, it was a whole different deal in the 80s and in the late 70s and 80s. And my first floor went vacant and I couldn't get it, or it didn't go vacant. I had it rented, but the guy wasn't paying me. And I couldn't get a call on an ad. I mean, people wouldn't even call. You'd run an ad. So I couldn't get anybody else in there. The guy was willing to leave, but he told me he'd pay me if this deal came through with him. And so I left him in there, you know. But he didn't have the money, and he kind of strung me along. But I had nothing better, so it didn't matter, really, you know. At least he was paying the utility bills. And, you know, I mean, it was helpful. So I lost 6 months' rent, and my house went into foreclosure, this triplex I'd been working on. My family was born there. My kids were born there. It was a big ego trip. I was trying to impress people. It was a huge building, 1,800 square feet on each floor, and I had three floors of it. And this was an incredible house or triplex. Well, I got to save this thing. And you know, I'm the kind of guy who can make some kind of a business deal happen. I can get out there, and I would pull a rabbit out of a hat once in a while, you know, things like that. I was good at that crap. So I'm out looking for a business deal that's going to bail out, because they won't accept payments once it's in foreclosure. You know, you have to pay the whole thing up. So now I'm going to save my house. And I got my kids living there and Pam's there. We had an 11-year relationship and two boys. My boys were 4 and 6 years old when I got sober. So now they're very young when this is going on, maybe 3 and 5 or something. 3 and 5. So anyway, there's a guy that used to do upholstery work for me. He had a little house in Minneapolis, and he wanted out of it, and he couldn't sell it because you couldn't get financing. Interest rates were 15%, and it was just crazy. So I wanted into this place because I figured I could fix it up, make some money, and then bail out the house I'm living in, see? So I start a contract for deed with him. I make a deal with him. I'm going to pay him 25 grand or something like that. The house is probably duplexed. It would probably be worth 55, we figured. So I figured I could make some money on this thing, and I'll bail out my house now. And I'm a plumber. I'm self-employed. I'm working for myself, and I'm trying to make something happen. So I give him, I told him I'd give him $3,000 down. I gave him $1,500 of it, and I had to come up with another $1,500. He said, okay. So we start, then the contract would start after I gave him the second $1,500, and I had a month to do that. So I'm out looking for now $1,500. And I happened to be buying some parts down at this guy's place. It was a store called Chicago Supply Company. The guy had bought the inventory. It was antique plumbing fixtures. And he had bought the inventory after a fire and moved it into downtown Minneapolis. And it was a huge inventory. He had probably 15,000 square feet of this stuff. And it's all antique, and the stuff's valuable if you can market it. I mean, back then there wasn't repro stuff. It was just, that was the way it was. So, and the salvage business makes a lot of money. You know, you buy a radiator for fins on the radiator. $1 a fin, you sell it for $15 a fin. I mean, the markup's phenomenal on this stuff if you can market it, see? And there was a market back then. This guy had just moved it. He was a plumber, and he had his kids working for him, 3-4 kids. They moved all this stuff. He's throwing toilets and dumpsters, and I'm in there talking to him, and he wants out of this. I mean, it's driving him crazy. He's got too much invested in it. He just wants to get out of it. Well, I'm talking to him. I want to get in this business because of how I feel about that salvage. I'm buying and selling stuff anyway. I'm kind of like Mr. Haney off Green Acres. Remember that guy? Yeah. So it's a sell anything you get your hands on, you know? So anyway, I'm talking to him. And he wants out. He tells me this. And I was going to buy some parts from him. He says, and I told him, I said, well, I got this house. And I told him the business deal I had going on. I says, maybe we can work something out. He says, well, I tell you what we'll do. We'll go in as a partnership. I'll pay your other $1,500 earnest money. We'll get the contract going. That's the first thing. Then we're going to fix it up. We're going to duplex it. We'll put a bathroom on the second floor. We'll go to the city, get it as a duplex. And then I'll buy it from you on an FHA loan. You'll take the funds that you make from the house. I'll place a mortgage for 55 grand on it. I'll give you, you'll get that profit. You give that back to me, I'll give you the store and the house. I got $1,500 in this. This isn't a bad deal, you know. So we go in and we start doing that. We fix it all up. We get a duplex and everything. He goes to place the financing on it. His financing fell through. Oh, then the game starts. Now I'm running the store. He's already given me the store, and I'm running it, see, you know. I assumed his lease and all that. It's crazy, you know. financing falls through, then the game starts, and it's a battle. I end up giving him the house, he gives me the store, and we parted ways. Lots of conflict in between. I'm not home much with my kids. I got trouble with Pam because of all this craziness I'm involved in, and it's just nuts. So now I'm trying to run this stupid store, and I'm way over my head. I don't know what I'm doing. I have no money. It's just insanity. This is, at this point, it's about 10,000 square feet of Looney Tunes, you know? So I'm trying to operate this thing. I got a bunch of dope fiends hanging around me. They're trying to help me, a bunch of speed freaks and stuff, and they're crazy. So we're doing this stuff, and I get in trouble with the landlord. The guy, I'm in the basement of this building. They're putting a restaurant in above me. The guy who I bought the inventory from is plumbing it, and he's letting those guys into my store when I'm not there. And they're plumbing it out of my inventory. I found that out later, see? Which was a little irritating. My snowblower disappeared and some things like that. And the guy who owns the building's doing this. Then he's got radiators leaking all over my inventory. It's damaging stuff, and I'm taking pictures because I think I can get some business stuff going. You know, take advantage of insurance money. You know what I mean, don't you, guys? You know, you ever do that sort of thing? So that's what I'm doing, all right? And the landlord won't give me his insurance company's name, and now I got a conflict with him, and he's putting in the restaurant, he tears my front stairs out, and people got to go around through a freight elevator. It's just a nightmare. So I do something that I love to do. This is brilliant. I like to tell people to stick it. You know what I mean? When I'm in a situation like that, it just feels so good just to tell them to go stick it. So I did. I'm going to move. To heck with you. Now, this is not in my best interests, trust me. To move this inventory is unbelievable. So I start moving it back in semi-trailers. You have a guy drop a trailer, 40-foot trailer. You load it up. Takes days to load it. Everything's fragile. Everything's heavy. You give guys speed, and they carry toilets and pipe fittings and radiators. You know what I mean? And we're loading all this crap up. So we're going to move it. We get that trailer loaded, pull it over to the new place. I pay $1,500 down on the new building. Okay, I start a lease for a year with Harold. Harold Steinman was the guy's name. Harold had a furniture store. He had a huge building. And I'm moving in. It's in a good area, I mean, for business for me. And it's a big building, man. Two floors of it. He's officing in there. He moved his stuff out for me to come in, a furniture store. So now I'm moving in. Pay him the first month's rent. Pay him half of the second. I don't have the second half of the second month's rent because I'm spending it on moving trucks and other things. Other records. You got to give guys speed. They won't carry this stuff. You know? It costs a lot of money to do this. So we're moving. Third month, I've got everything in this new place. I've bought shelving. I got everything on shelves. It's unpacked. I got display cases set up, you know, 6-7 display cases and a big horseshoe. This is a huge proposition to do. It takes 3.5 months to move it in one direction. I'm in the third month. Harold wants his money. I don't have the last half of the second month. I don't have the third month's rent. I said, Harold, I'll get it for you. I promise you I'll get you the money. I got to get the doors open here. This is killing me. This is costing me a fortune. I had no intention of cheating him. I'm not going to cheat him. I'm going to pay him. He looks at me after about a week. He says, get your crap out of here. Oh, I know. I couldn't believe he said it. No talk, no conversation. Just get your crap out of here. I got to load all this stuff up again. I don't have the money to rent the next place. Where do you get the money? Well, you do things you said you'd never do with people I swore I'd never be with. You cheat people in any way you can to get the money. You can't just drop the inventory because it's going to bail out the house I'm losing. You understand? I've been able to stall a sheriff's sale long enough. 2-3 years I was able to put that off through something called a moratorium act back then. And there was a lot of ways of playing the games, and I'm good at playing games. Wow, I got to move this again. And I'm out doing all kinds of things that I would not normally do because I can't just drop this and walk. I'm going to lose everything if I do. So we back in the semi-trailers again. We find the next place, $2,000 on the next place, start pulling the stuff over there. At the end of 4 months, Harold is paying his own men to load his own trucks to get me out of his place. And they're dropping my stuff outside of this other building, and it rains and things like that, and it ruins the inventory, you know, pipe fitting. I mean, huge 6-inch diameter pipe fittings and nipples and things. This stuff is outrageously expensive if you had to buy it. Wow. And it seems, and I'm not home reading my kids' stories at night. You know, I got trouble with Pam. I got trouble beyond, I mean, I'm not even telling you the tip of the problems that happened throughout this exchange. But I got it moved. 8.5 months of moving, solid. What a nightmare. I'm not open. I got trouble at home. I'm missing my kids' birthday parties. I'm not there for Christmas. I'm just crazy. And it seems to me I wouldn't have all these problems if it wouldn't have been for Harold forcing me to move. That's the way it seemed to me, okay? So here's the story. I'm resentful at Harold. What's the cause? He forced me to move all that stuff a second time. How did that affect me? Here, I'll give you this. On our grudge list, the third column, we set opposite each name our injuries. Was it our self-esteem that was injured? You think? You think I looked kind of bad to people, you know? Yeah, my self-esteem was injured. Did it affect my security, meaning financial? It devastated me financially. Did it affect my ambitions, my goals for life? Yeah, I lost my family. Pam finally left me during that time, and then we got back together and left again and that kind of stuff, you know? She'd had it. I lost the house we were living in during that time. I lost that triplex. I had $50,000 in equity in that one building. That was a lot of money in the 80s. Gone in a foreclosure. Did it affect my money, my security, my ambitions, my goals? Yeah. Lost my family, lost everything. Did it affect my personal or sex relations? Yeah, it ended my sex relations. Yeah. Man, I was rageful. I got to tell you, I wanted to kill Harold. I, honest to God, he was officing in that building, and I was going through his stuff, and I made up a little dossier on him. You know, I knew where he lived. I was actually going to murder him. Seriously. Seriously, I was. I'm not kidding about that, man. I was planning it. I had keys to his cars and stuff, and I ended up stealing his car. Oh, yeah. Cut it up with a torch. Yeah. This is sad. This is a sad deal. So that's what went on. That's what went on. And I come into AA with all this rage, and I got to do something with this thing. So I start writing it out. I get the story written out. I flip the page over. Now I'm going to look for my mistakes. First question, where had we been selfish? Here's the way the thoughts came to me. Now, I don't believe in God, but I'm getting thoughts in my mind that aren't my thoughts. I don't believe in God. I'm an atheist. And here's how the voice talks to me. And I've had this happen a number of times. It said, when I said, where had I been selfish in the situation with Harold? The voice said, Rick. Why would I say Rick to myself? You know, that bothered me, guys. Honest to God. That bothered me to no end. It sounded like my voice in my head, but it says Rick. Then it says, here's how it came. Harold was reacting to you. What? Yeah. Harold was reacting. All I've asked is, where was I selfish? Harold was reacting to you. You tied his building up for 8.5 months. You paid him a month and a half rent, and you're mad at him? Never thought of that. You know, when I would tell that story to people that we're hanging with, I would always leave out the fact that I didn't pay him the rent, or I would disguise it in some way. I would not be honest. And then we'd hate Harold together, see? And then we'd get even and punish Harold and do things to him. Oh, yeah, this is ugly, just ugly. Now you say, any damn fool could see that, right? Oh, really? How about when you're emotional about this stuff? Do you think I wanted to be responsible for the failure in my family? Do you think I wanted to be responsible for the loss of my children? Do you think I wanted to be responsible for my inability to deal with that business? Do you think I wanted to be responsible for the loss of my house? When I saw somebody to hang all that crap on, Harold, I put it all on him. And I blinded myself to the obvious. You say, well, any damn fool could see that. Not when you're emotional. Not when you don't want to see it and you want somebody else to be responsible. And I blinded myself to all that. Like my life was just pristine until Harold came along. Hey, I was the problem for Harold. His life might have been pristine until I came along. What a nightmare for him. He moved his furniture store out of there. Wow, where was I selfish? You know what happened? I saw that my story wasn't accurate. Harold didn't do all these things to me, but yet I'd been hating him for what? All of my mistakes. Who are you hating when you're hating somebody for your mistakes? You're hating yourself outside of yourself. So you know what I was doing? I was forgiving myself by seeing Harold differently. Why? Because I stopped hating somebody for ruining my life, and I lifted the hate off of myself at the same time. I didn't understand any of this, but I felt the release.
But you know how you can do that? His motives were good. See, he can do that because he wasn't trying to cheat Harold. He was going to pay him. He was going to pay him.
I was.
That's how you can make that justify in your mind. I was going to pay him.
But you see, all of my failures were tied during that experience of you know, my family troubles, my house troubles, and there was just a big lie going on because I used that. He was the scapegoat for all of my crap. But I broke through, and I saw it. And I went from hating him one minute to realizing I owe him an amend. How do you go from hating somebody to realizing you owe him an amend in about 5 minutes of writing, unless you've had a transformation of your mind? Well, I had such a transformation. And it did shift. And I did have to go back and talk to Harold. But I didn't have the guts to tell him I stole his car. He was hooked to organized crime, guys. Oh, yeah. This would have really been ugly, man. If he knew what I did to him. Oh, I didn't have the guts. I just couldn't do it. I was too afraid. Sad as that is, that's a fact. But it broke through, and I saw the lie. And I went back and I told him I'd pay him any money I owed him and whatever I had to do, you know, to clean up my mess. And he was very decent with me. He's dead now. I didn't kill him either. So my story wasn't accurate, but yet all that energy I poured into hating him was the same energy I was hating myself with. So I was hating myself outside of myself. So what we're doing with this inventory is you're starting to forgive yourself by seeing others differently. And that was the sense of my experience with that. So that was an experience. And later on, where we meet again, we'll give you some other personal stuff. But this thing with my dad was huge. That's the one. Guys always have problems with their dads. Women generally have problems. Not always, but generally have problems with their mothers. The thing with my dad was huge. Here, guys, you know, here, let me do this. Let me tell you this something. I want to tell you something that happened, and it was recent. And I'll run and read something to you real quick. I'll do this quick. There was a young gal who came into our meeting, okay? She was an Asian gal, or is an Asian gal, and that was. She still is Asian, yeah. We didn't change that, but. But she was about 16, 17 years old. She was following an older Asian lady into the meeting who were in her early 20s. And I knew her a little bit. I knew the older one, but I didn't know Ruby was this younger one's name. Well, Ruby, neither one of them stayed. They came and back and forth, and they had a little understanding of things, but they weren't interested. So she disappeared, and then she came back about four years later. So she's in her early 20s now. She calls me up, and I never knew her very well, but she calls me up, and she says, I can't do this. I got to get sober. I says, well, come on in. We'll get you meditate, and I learn TM and that sort of thing, and we'll get you through the inventory stuff, and we'll get some people to help you, network with you, okay? So she comes in. She's going to meetings and stuff. She's coming through these workshops that we're doing, and she's not writing anything. She won't write. She just won't do it. So I don't push at her, let her be. You know, she goes back out, drinks some more, she comes back. Then she calls me after a few months. She says, I'm suicidal now. Every time I drink, I want to kill myself. I'm literally going to kill myself. I'm scared to death. I'm going to kill myself if I keep drinking. So she's at that point. I says, Ruby, you got to do inventory. You got to write this. She'd been to the workshop. I says, you know how to do this. You have to write it. She would not put the pen to paper. She says, my sponsor won't let me. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. This is the kind of stuff we got going on. I looked at her. I didn't look at her. I'm on the phone with her. I says, Ruby, I don't care what your sponsor said. You got to do this or you're going to die. So she did. And I met with her later on after she wrote for about 2 hours. She was different. Something shifted in her. We're sitting at dinner and she had a major shift. We're talking a little bit. She has more. I can see it's still happening. She's in a process, and we're talking a little bit about some stuff, and it's shifting more and more and more. We parted that night. 2 days later, she sends me a text message. Here's what she sent me. Have you ever had a back massage, a really good one that works out all those kinks and knots, and afterwards you're so loosened up, you're almost uncomfortable because you're not used to feeling that way? That's how my mind is today. My thoughts don't hurt me today. Wow. And I have these moments of sadness, but there is none of the heart-wrenching pain that I was feeling for so long. Wow. How could you put that any better? It shifted. A couple days later, I got a text from her. She says, I don't think I'll have to drink anymore. And she hasn't. And she's excited, and she's working in the program with other women and doing 12-step work. She's about pushing a year now sober. She runs our meeting.
Yeah, she's our trusted servant squad leader now.
If you're not having this experience that I just read you, you're missing it. You're missing it. This is about transformation of mind, and no less. I got to tell you, she said that better than I could ever say it in 100 years. So I think that a lot of times, like her sponsor, won't let her write inventory. She's going to die. This is the kind of controlling stuff that's going on where I come from. Isn't that sad? Wow, the arrogance of some of us thinking we know. Somebody might die if you do that. So that was quite an experience for me.